lost your mind yet? Ah, welcome to the video. Have you lost your mind yet? Are you shifted into functional insanity yet? Hopefully not. Because why we have good habits, I have to speak quietly, neighbors are out gardening and stuff. So. Good habits. This is what it's all about, good habits. This is what religion is all about, as a matter of fact. People, sometimes they look at religion and say, well, you know, they don't really have that the answers. Well, good habits are the answer. Because you're never going to get to the real truth of the situation without good habits. So pragmatically, they're the road you have to take. And people also ask, well, how do we get such bad habits? Just look at this world right now. Ants, there's the answer. This world is generating incredibly bad habits. And this just goes on all over the cosmos. This is Exhibit A. This world is Exhibit A. Bad habit central. Bad habit USA. So there it is. I support all religions because the basic principle of religions is to cultivate good habits. This is their purpose. Once they get these good habits and you're able to really contain the gospel, the good news, then you can start finding out the real truth about the situation. Religions themselves do not contain the real truth of the situation. That's not their purpose, because you can't understand it until you have really good habits. You cannot. You will distort it. You will flip it. You will twist it. You'll be unable to full stop in the wow. You will spin it. Useless. First comes the good habits. And this is what I've preached my whole life, and this is what people have ignored in the world. Because schools teach us that knowledge, intellect is the answer. Intellect has nothing to do with it. It's good habits are the answer. Are you able to sit down every day, quietly center yourself in positive truth? Knowing that I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. And allow the upwelling of clarity to experience this. So the point where you feel, wow, this is just amazing. And then full stop in the wow. See, these are good habits. Without these good habits, this upwelling cannot take place. Will not take place. It will freak you out. So, again, the fact that religions, when it comes to the actual full gospel, or, you know, don't really have it, they don't have it, that's okay. Doesn't matter. Because once you get the good habits, you'll be able to see, the truth is within all of us. It automatically will arise within us once we have our good habits. That's it. And it's beyond description anyway, basically. The good news is so great that, you know, you cannot just write it out there for people so easily and expect them to accept it. But no way. You need the good habits first. So, religion is all about saying, hey, these are the good habits. These are some of the good habits that will help you restore your relationship with God. You know, or at least realize it never was broken. See, we think we broke it. So these are the good habits that help you realize that you can't break your relationship. You cannot break your perfect relationship with God. And it's a lifelong endeavor. Good habits are not easy to come by, and breaking bad habits are not easy to do. For sure, I have seen how people have worked on bad habits in this world to such an extraordinary extent that it's not going to be easy to break those bad habits. It is going to be very difficult, but they have no choice. They have to. Our relationship with God is absolutely perfect. And to continue to believe that somehow it's been disrupted is just a dream of delusion. And the habits that support that dream of delusion, I have no choice but to set them down, the bad habits, and pick up good habits. What are the good habits of religion? Sitting quietly. Listening to something that transcends our intellect. Getting used to the fact that there is some great good news for us. Not arguing, not disputing, not dialoguing, not analyzing, not intellecting, none of this stuff. Be quiet and realize the truth is within you, and you must prepare for this truth. Simple habits, so you can, your life is slow. Your life is slow, the pace of life is slow. You can stop at any time. You feel like you're never too busy for God, never too busy for the truth. You're not frazzled, you're not rattled. You're able to spend blocks of time, and on and on and on. You don't eat, well, for instance, you don't eat things that really stimulate your intellect and body, and the body too much like meat. And you know, vegetarianism is a very good principle. Not eating, not overeating. No drugs, no stimulants. Strict morality. Strict ethics and morality are all good. That keeps you leading a simple, basic life. Not trying to grab too much of the world, okay? So that you can spend more time listening to the good news which is within us. And severely curtail entertainment, which tends to pull us away severely. Do not use human figures in advertising. I think that's the most important habit of religion, good habit of religion that I've seen, because I've seen the ruinous effects of this. And I give credit to the religion of Islam for holding that very important. You cannot use human likenesses in advertising, marketing at all. This is super important. It's had such a ruinous effect, and it has cultivated the most extraordinary bad habits for so many people. Any human form, especially the female form, especially, but any human form, let's not get fancy, just say human forms are not allowed in marketing, advertising, products, services. De-emphasizing the human form is very important. De-emphasizing the body, cover the body up. Try to wear long sleeve shirts, cover the shoulders, cover the neck. This is a very important. So you have these various religions that have various strengths. Christianity has had a lot of strength with forgiveness, compassion. Christianity has more to do with attitudes, okay? Even though it had sumptuary laws and very, those have been sort of termited. But compassion, mercy, forgiveness, love, meekness, humility, turn the other cheek, all these beatitudes that Jesus gave us, those are super important habits. Islam is also very, very helpful. It has more to do with external habits as far as how you present yourself in the world. It has a lot to do with that. Don't try to be glamorous. Don't try to attract attention to your body. Very important. Be humble, self-effacing. In public, do not try to draw attention, you know, all these things. No stimulants, tea, coffee, no alcohol. That's a very important one. No alcohol. Absolutely not. Alcohol should not be available at all, as a matter of fact. Super bad breeder of bad habits. No gambling. Gambling is a very, very bad habit. No prostitution. Very, very bad habit. All these terrible habits that breed massive amounts of bad habits. These are breeders of bad habits. These things cannot be tolerated at all. You will just breed bad habit and then just creating a mess for yourself down the road. A mess for yourself down the road. And yes, this body, one life of a body is not the end, because as long as you have bad habits, you will come back to indulge those bad habits with the body, for sure. Sooner or later, you will find all these bad habits waiting for you. You kick them down the road, keep trying to kick them down the road, you will come across them, for sure, and then you will greatly regret the folly of your life. And you wonder, well, how is this possible? Well, you spent your time in a secular, humanistic dystopia, is how. Do not emphasize the human form. Wear loose, non-revealing clothes. Okay, doesn't reveal the form, doesn't accentuate it. You don't go to hair salons, you don't fancy yourself, glamorize yourself at all. These are just basic good habits. Yeah. So religion is super helpful for us in the main trouble with religions is because they don't contain the higher teachings. They tend to get antagonistic to one another and thinking, well, we got the answer. They should realize, no, the higher teachings are not currently contained in these religions. So stop fighting one another over this. Ridiculous. Religion is just a support for one another. They're saying good habits are what religion's all about. Leave the higher teachings for those who have already accumulated the great good habits and can truly full stop and wow of the full gospel. If there's any competition, that'd be a friendly competition of who can adhere to the good habits best. Like that, there should be an ecumenical spirit in the world of who can adhere to these good habits the best, and let's encourage one another to adhere to these good habits. So the assault on religion is a worldwide assault. All religions are being assaulted and termited by secular humanism, which is a vicious monster that breeds bad habits. Its very purpose is to breed bad habits. That's its purpose. Through all this, I can speak with absolute authority on this, that your bad habits, you can't escape them. You cannot escape them. They will catch up to you, and you will pay the price for sure. So be smart. And you may say, well, we're really up against it right now in the world, which is true, because the CCC, Cosmic Corporate Culture, has taken over this planet and incorporated it. And basically working to just plunge everyone into this state of agitation and confusion and non-functionality, and just does this too much, and then they will come on the scene and say, don't worry, we're going to reorganize the whole planet, and everything will be functional and everything will work great for you. Just have to go through this tough times here. They have a wonderfully funny ways of marketing their nonsense. But it is curtains here at this time. And this is when good habits come to the front. Do you have the good habits? Those with the good habits are able to allow the fullness of the gospel to arise now. You can't gain good habits and break all your bad habits. And just like that, with an intellectual flick of the switch, doesn't work that way. That's why Jesus always exhorted us to prepare, meaning build good habits. Don't build your house upon straw or sand or something, you know, build it upon a rock. What is the rock? Good habits. Now, those who don't have the good habits, they feel like they're toast, you know. Start good habits. So look, realize that you will find yourself identifying with a body again at some point, so you can indulge those bad habits. So start building in good habits right now to help offset that, because the good habits have to win out. So you may not get to supernature. You may not find yourself free of this whole nonsense, this whole marketing campaign of life and death, marketing nothing to God, essentially marketing nothing at all to God. And not what can never exist, which is lack of freedom. We're really marketing lack of freedom to God. Hey God, we got this wonderful product for you. God says, I don't see anything there. And never will, God never will. So as we go forward in this lunatic, silly, whimsical marketing campaign, building bad habits like this, start building in good habits so you can flip this script and say, hey, I don't need to do this anymore. I've got super nature waiting for me. I've got this vision of oneness waiting for me. And this, you know, there I market nothing to God. Hey, God, here, I'm marketing nothing to you. And God say, well, ah, that's very nice. And then you're on the same page. Yeah, there really is nothing there, right? So yeah, this is why I'm marketing nothing. And then gradually realize, I guess I don't even need to have to market it, right? Because there's nothing there. Why do I need to market it? Don't need to. And then you're finished. We're finished marketing all together. We can set it down. Is there neither marketing life nor death? You know, this is not. It's super nature. It's kind of like neither one. You know, which is? I don't really know. It's really nothing. I don't really have anything to market. Okay, let me market nothing to you, God. Whereas now we're trying to market life to God and death to God. Then we'll say, let's market nothing to God. So, you know, if you haven't had the good habits, the fullness of the gospel cannot arise. It will freak you out and continuity fear will overwhelm you. So what do? Start working on good habits and just, you know, just say, wow, use your will. Say, I've got to. Otherwise, you're going to pay the price one way or the other, but you better have good habits. And from experience, I can tell you this is how it works. I had a lot of bad habits, and I had some good habits where I was able to spend long periods of time carefully waiting for inspiration to arise. And when it came to music, composing music, you wait for inspiration to arise. You focus your mind. You're quiet. So you use that capacity to contemplate truth and work on allowing the fullness of the gospel, the good news, to arise within me. And that gradually, you know, eroded the bad habits away. Great deal of patience, great deal of perseverance, and patience. I had all those habits of patience and perseverance, quietly waiting. I don't try to force things. You know, I used a espresso coffee in a previous life to try and force the inspiration. You know, and try to, right? That's a big mistake. Very, very nasty mistake. Caffeine is a nasty mistake. One of the worst, but there's so many bad ones. There's so many bad habits. I've gone on at length about caffeine and how it disrupts your capacity to allow this full stop in the wow, that you keep overriding it. You overwhelm yourself, and then you we backslide. And then that diminishes, undermines the path. It seems to make you go faster, but the net result is it undermines your faith in the path. So here we are. Those who have worked on good habits are be richly rewarded. Sidestep this monster. Technology. I had to buy a new all-in-one laser jet printer today. All-in-one, right? And I just realized how much I hate technology, how totally burned out I am about it. Having gone through the whole thing, dragged through it, just feeling violated the whole way, just so horrible, horrible experience. Just to test technology, it's for losers. It's for those who have severely bad habits and trying to increase their bad habits. And you know, you run about a 50% chance at least of the thing not working, the driver software, the CD, you know, something going wrong, right? And breaking soon, you know, in a couple weeks, or anything can happen, and usually does happen. And I reached a point where I couldn't take it anymore. I've been traumatized so many times by technology. Vicious trauma. People talk about rape. I call this technological rape. Extreme violation of our trust and our expectations by these snake oil salesmen and sales ladies, for sure. Ladies are even more rapacious than the men these days about selling technology. I just got a lady selling me stuff. My God, she's like a lizard lady. And just okay, got this. Scan this. Okay, yeah. It's like, wow. The lizard ladies are all over the place these days. And so I just completely burned out on technology. I don't want anything to do in the future with technology whatsoever. I want to live in a tech-free realm. Okay, tech-free realm. That's condition number one for sure. No technology allowed. This greatly helps us calm down, focus in, and allow the fullness of the gospel to arise to our attention. Of what are we really? What are we really? We are so forgetful of what we are. We think we're marketers of some non-existent product, that this is our role, this is our function. We think this marketing campaign is what we are. We've identified with this campaign so much, we think that's what we are. But if this is a ridiculous caricature, cartoon-like caricature. This world is like a ridiculous cartoon. Bodies are just cartoon characters. There's nothing, this world and this marketing campaign has absolutely zero to do with what we are. And we need to allow the fullness of this truth to arise within us and be recognized and accepted. And the wow is going to be there. So we need full stop in the wow. Now, I'm pragmatic. I have this simple little camera here, $100 camera. Pieces have broken, the mounting thing just broke, you know, but it still works, okay. All I do is click, you know, click, go, pretty much so. Adjust the lighting a little bit, okay, that's fine, all right. Upload to YouTube, boom, all right, that's it. Okay, pragmatically, I'm willing to do that. But as far as the culture goes, which is becoming totally dependent upon technology, no, no, and no is for reprobates who have extraordinarily bad habits, and they don't even know what good habits are. So they don't even realize that they're missing out, and how this badly this interferes with good habits, how badly it interferes with them. They're ignorant. Okay, so you have a world being run by ignoramuses. There's very little that information needs to be transmitted anywhere, actually. Just sit quietly, calm your mind, say, I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. Truth is true, nothing else is true. Allow yourself to calm down. And put yourself in a willingness to be shocked, temporarily, your functionality to be shocked by how great the good news is. So you feel like, I don't have to do anything. I can just sit here. This is the whole key to salvation, is I don't have to do anything. I can just sit here. And when you feel that way, then you will, that will allow these clarifications that arise within you. The truth is within us. It arises, and we become aware of it in our mind. We say, wow, that's fantastic. That's wonderful. But I don't know how to react to that or how to function. The whole landscape has suddenly shifted on me. Great. But guess what? I don't have to do anything. I can just sit here. So the whole cult, the best culture is the culture that says, I can just sit here. Nobody's going to page me. Nobody's going to call me. Nobody's going to force me into doing anything. I don't feel any guilt about it. I feel this is very righteous, what I'm doing, just sitting here quietly. Put your attention, ask for truth, put your attention, get ready to say, I'm ready for the wow. And my experience is it always arises. When you are receptive to it, it arises. So this is the very principle of salvation, is receptivity to the good news. Putting yourself as receptive to the good news of salvation. These are what the good habits aim you towards. To calm your system down. Stop the stimulants, the red meat, the sex, the drugs, the rock and roll, the gratuitous, the entertainment, everything that riles you up. Those are all bad, bad habits. Thinking about innovating, creating gadgets, making gadgets, all this stuff riles your intellect up. You want that to calm down. I don't have to create, sustain, maintain, or dissolve anything. I don't have to create, maintain, nor dissolve anything. I don't have to go up. I don't have to be striving upwards in society or going down. So society is just this collective effort to support one another without need of social ambitions, without ambitions of trying to be greater or greater than others. nor are we slaves to any state or officialdom at all. Two different ways that people go about it. Some want a centralized bureaucracy of religion that makes sure the habits are uniform everywhere. That would be like Roman Catholicism or Shia Islam, for instance. Or some want localized religious instruction. That would be like Protestantism, or Sunni Islam. Or with the imams, you know, they have localized religious leaders who help the community, you know, clarify what are the best good habits that, you know, we can be engaged in here. What is that? I don't know. Some elect their leaders who are shown the most capable ones. Others insist on being appointed from a hierarchy, like Roman Catholicism. Okay, so there's disagreements about that, you see. But the more you get involved in these disagreements, the less time you practice good habits. Yeah. And there's really, bottom line is, sitting quietly and feeling I don't have to do anything. That's the best good habit to have, and anyone can do that anytime, anywhere. Keeping your body mellow, lowly, not drawing attention, not trying to get involved with all this physicality and all this kind of stuff. These are basic good teachings. And then so it's a shame that religion has had these struggles between, you know, hierarchical structure and more localized structure. that detracts from just letting go of everything. I don't have to solve any problems. The answer's already within me. The only problem is I think I have a problem, ultimately. The economy should be very simple. Just staples, that's it. Should not be a materialistic economy. Just have some, you know, bread and cheese on the table, you know, just some fruit, some bread, cheese, you know, basic food, just basic food, basic lodging, basic clothes. That's it. That's all that's needed. And spend your time sitting quietly, and you will find you become very, very wise, and you have much revealed to you. You can also read various holy books that challenge you and say, hey, consider this, that's can be part of it too. But ultimately, it's your full stop in the wow, it's your own mental discipline. That's the most important aspect of it all. So, 2:15 is when the freak out starts to happen. People start freaking out. They start losing their minds. Those who don't have good habits, they will fall apart. They're falling apart already. They're becoming very demanding, very angry, lashing out, they're falling apart. And so, what do? We retreat into good habits. We maintain our good habits. This is all important. Our good humor, our ecumenical compassion, imagine if you want a backpack trip, yeah, with a bunch of people, group, and you decided, I don't feel like taking any water, so I don't like people telling me what to do, so I'm just gonna leave the water and the food. Yeah, I don't need food. Food, I don't want to take it. It's too much of a burden for me. So you get out there on the trip, and everybody's says, oh, eating and drinking, you don't have anything. Say, hey, what's going on here? You know, why should I have to, deal with this? Well, when you're building good habits, it's a burden, right? And you feel, why should I have people telling me what to do? I want to do whatever I want to do. Well, it's needed. There needs to be people pressuring you and supporting, saying, hey, keep working on these good habits. Because if you don't, you're hurting society. Just like if you don't bring water and food on a backpack trip, you've made all those other people carry it for you. And then you're going to feed off of them, whine and complain. So society is definitely affected by bad and good habits. And we are creatures of society. Actually, as just a phrase, not literally. Because we're spirit, we're not creatures, but we are affected by society. So society is made up of habits, the habits of people, their attitudes, their habits. And so bad habits have a very nasty effect on society. They pull other people into bad habits. I mean, I go out in the world and I see nothing but bad habits, actually, among people. I don't see any good habits. I don't think people have them anymore. Really, just basic civility, you know, that's about it. You know, you cannot make any wise aside to anybody, and you're in the grocery store line, and I try, they say, hey, and a little conversation as they're checking you out. And you can't just use something and make a little phrase like, you know, to just kind of clue someone into non-duality or clue them into, like, yeah, your habits and good habits. No, they're like, huh, what? You know, it's like they're oblivious to it. Oblivious to it. This is part of culture and society, is use your humor and your awareness and alertness to the things that arise in your life. Oh, that reminds me. That reminds me. That reminds me. So the stuff that we encounter in the world is supposed to remind us. Oh, that reminds me of how important good habits are. That reminds me of the truth and that is all the singularity of truth. That reminds me that I need to be very careful and not, you know, this reminds me. And pointing out reminders to others too. You're supposed to reinforce one another. This is just basic culture. So we have backslid so severely that nobody even has a clue what I'm talking about. Hardly. You know, there's something that needs to be meta-talk. Like if you look at a magazine, you see some, you know, modern age, you see so much terrible stuff. You look at that, oh, that reminds me of how horrible secular humanism is. Look how vacuous this person is, drawing attention to her body and how she looks and not giving even a single reinforcement of any good habits whatsoever. That reminds me how terrible secular humanism. Why am I even looking at this trash? Who cares what's in the magazine? They're just using that to pull us in so we get these, start, you know, to try to ingrain bad habits of our attention. This is what they do. They're very clever. And so we can just laugh and point out the cleverness and how silly that they thought we're so stupid that we can't see through this. You know, this is funny. The mind thinking that it's tricking itself is quite hilarious. And you can talk about how awful television is and laugh at it. You know, this is culture. Culture is to laugh at what is, you know, the bad habits. Laughing at bad habits is very important. People have forgotten to laugh at bad habits. Now they're encouraging them to think it's very serious. This is super important. Yeah, the ETs won't like us unless we really have a lot of bad habits. Why? So you can forgive theirs, right? So they can have leverage over us. They can say, you don't like our bad habits. Well, look at you. Look at your terrible bad habits. You know, you want us to clean up ours. You'll have to clean up yours first. You know, we'll say, oh, no, that's too tough. Oh, my God. No, okay. Okay, ET. Okay, CCC. Come on in. I'm sorry. I'm trying to take a hard line. But if you had good habits, really good, you look at this cosmic corporate culture and say, hey, get your bad habits out of here. We're not interested in you bringing this stuff in here. In fact, you're pathetic. It's ridiculous. It's just laughable. Laughable. And they say, well, you know, what about your bad habits? I say, what? I don't have bad habits. I have good habits. You got to clean up. Well, oh, sure, fine. I'm all for cleaning up bad habits. And that's what both do that, won't we? You start cleaning up your good habits, and you mean you start cleaning up your bad habits, and I'll make sure I stay on, keep my good habits going. And we don't really need you here. We're doing fine with our good habits here. You see how that would prevent it? Incorporation taking over. So what they did first is they dragged us all down into severely bad habits. So now they can come in and we don't have a leg to stand on. They say, well, you're worse than we are. So who are you to tell us we can't come here? What kind of moral authority do you have? See how clever they are? The lizard people, the conglomeration of all sorts of types. The Nordics with their all their attitudes, and the Greys with all their trickiness, you know, and they have so many bad habits. It's absurd, totally laughable. So, but if you're again saddled with all your terrible, and you know, who are you to talk? See, so this is why they try to collapse the moral authority of this planet. And they've done a very good job of that. It's all just a bunch of rhetoric right now. Wow. Nobody cares for rhetoric. You gotta have the habits. The priests try as hard as they can. I mean, we've had some great priests. Respect them greatly. And they try. They say, hey, you know, 6 minutes a day, or just a few minutes every day. First they tried, you know, 20 minutes, or half an hour, now 6 minutes, and just spend some quiet time. You know, at the dinner table, start talking about your lives and start having a dialogue, a spiritual dialogue of how did your experiences today impact your spirituality and your good habits, instead of just everyone glued to the television or their smartphone or something. It's just ruining the family. As they said, this is ruining the family. It's ruining culture, and they're absolutely right about that. So again, anyone who advocates good habits is a friend of mine. Doesn't matter whether it's done by hierarchical way, centralized bureaucratic way, or on the localized way, both are welcome. More the merrier. I mean, let's have reinforcement all throughout society of good habits, and we can certainly get along. I can understand both ways. People living way out in the outback, they don't have any bureaucracy reaching them. They need to each clan and tribe needs to have their own, nomadic people need to have their own code of good habits. And they run into some other clan who has different code of good habits. And they say, hey, you're interfering with our good habits. Oh, you're interfering with ours, you know. And that can easily get into conflict. And then the bureaucratic structure says, hey, you know, if we could standardize it in both places, then there wouldn't be so much conflict. So you can understand both points of view. It's not easy to standardize for nomadic people, and they're way out in the mountains and stuff. You know, it's not easy, right? So it's hard. It's difficult to say. It's a difficult problem. But what people should say is, well, okay. Maybe some of your good habits are a little different than ours, but let's at least reinforce the good habits that we can agree upon, you know, that kind of thing. And it's not an easy situation, but the less conflict, the people can conflict, the better. Beyond that, that's a bad habit right there. Let your, you know, try and stay within your good habits, and everyone can just say, hey, I can just sit here and do nothing. That's the best good habit of all. And people with different good habits tend to stay away from one another because they can interfere. There's no question about it. So the priests tried mightily, and I've just been assessing the whole situation, and say, and next week they say, okay, who tried the prayer, and who tried the family thing, and who, you know, made an effort? Anyone? Nobody raises their hand. Nobody. Really? Nobody out there? Nobody tried? People, you know, this is what's been going on for years and years and years and years and years. I see them make great efforts, exhort the congregation to practice this, these good habits. Next week they ask, who practiced them? Nobody. Almost nobody. People there just say, it's just too difficult. I just want a ticket to heaven. Give me the Eucharist and then I'm fine. Other stuff doesn't matter. Yes, it does matter. The ticket to heaven is within us. Now, the Eucharist is a way just for everybody to share the same good habit. Wherever you go in the world, you take, you know, the communion, so yeah, I do the same thing you do the same thing. And it's a way to say we all share at least this one habit kind of thing, right? That's one way to look at it. Standardize, way to standardize something. Let's have ritual that standardizes and we can all feel that we belong to a certain extent. So the people are not practicing good habits. It's very clear. I mean, did you do this? Yeah, I did it. No, nobody raises their hand. Remember the last homily, the father said, these smartphones and tablets and all this entertainment stuff is ruining, collapsing, destroying the family, and therefore destroying good habits in your lives, family. The nexus of the soil in which good habits are started and grow is the family. And the parents are supposed to pass on, and the grandparents and relatives are supposed to pass on good habits to the children, along with their religious instruction. This is, religious instruction is all about good habits. It's supposed to be. It's supposed to be primarily about that. Because again, people cannot fathom the truth, the non-dual, abstract, totally abstract truth, with so many bad mental habits. First, the good habits. So whatever fairy tales they want to tell, whatever, the good habits are what's important. And those start in the family, with, all right? Around the tip of the table, the food, the pharmaceutical companies know very well that you can sell people on, doctors on what they want to sell you. First the banquet, the food, bring them to resort, feed them, you know what I mean? And then it's a lot easier to get them to agree to, yeah, I want you to prescribe these drugs, even if the people aren't sick. You know, they should be sick anyway, right? We've got this great product, and it's not so bad to just say, you know, that you're fortunate to even have this product. So whether they're sick or not, you know, it's a blessing for them either way, right? So just prescribe for them. Oh, you got a cold? Oh, okay, here's the medicine. You know, for me. When I get something, there's no even thought of going to a doctor or taking any medicine. It doesn't even enter my mind. What I do is I realize, oh, I invited this illness in. Why did I do that? Let me start looking at this. So this illness that I have had for, today's the 10th day. It's starting to leave because I realize I don't need it. I'm trying to get back on track. Got a little off track for a while, and I'm getting back on track and more light and positive. And hey, this is great. Everything's great. Let's be humorous. This sales campaign, we've been trying to sell God on nothing. You know, this is very funny. We need to shift lighter and lighter and lighter mode about the whole thing. Not get pulled down into doom and gloom. that we need to keep our good habits going, because the purpose of the doom and the gloom is just to break our good habits. Absolutely, that's the purpose. If they don't break our good habits, they failed. Because the gospel, the truth within us, is that we're perfectly free. We're not. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. This is the fact. And we're just imagining all this stuff. And there's no time boundness to anything we're imagining whatsoever. Nothing has any actual duration to it of our experiencing, other than our desire that we keep experiencing it. There isn't any external intrinsic force binding us to anything. None whatsoever. Never has been. As I say over and over again, there is no world. There's never been a world, and there never will be any world. Never. So there isn't any such thing as forces that are binding us to our experiencing, either forcing us to keep an experience or forcing us to change our experience. Neither one exists. There isn't any such forces at all. Never has been and never will be. Not even the tiniest iota of them, of such nonsense. So listening to truth is a very good habit. This is one that I've been practicing for my entire life. Started out listening to my dad, who would use the dinner time as a time to give all sorts of wise little spiritual stories that he was very good at. He was a spiritual raconteur, storyteller. Very good. Just so many little things. So he would use the dinner time to tell these stories, and I love that. You know, and I could say, "Ah, oh, that's great." because the other people didn't bore us. So important. What does this have to do with, you know, anything? So, and then I started reading books as soon as I could, and, you know, always put your mind on truth. Put your mind on truth. That's a discipline. That's a good habit. Be able to sit down. Let me sit down. I'm going to spend 3 hours studying this book very carefully. Maybe 6, maybe 8 hours. And then considering it. My whole life has been like this. This is a life well lived. This is what religion tells us to study your holy books every day, every day. Of course, there's troubles arise. They tell them this is the only holy book there is, it can ever be. And you know, they don't want the people thinking that they need to somehow become some sort of taste tester for all different approaches, because you can waste a lot of time that way. So they say, hey, just find what's best for you and just stick with it. But that's not to say there aren't many holy books around. There are, actually. But don't waste time thinking you need to master them. Oh, what is that? What you need is good habits. Don't need to master anything. You need good habits that enable you to full stop in the wow. This is the best habit. Just, I don't need to do anything except wow. Just full stop in the wow. This information is fantastic. This is great news. Good news. I'm overwhelmed by it. I'm stunned. The whole landscape has changed. I realize there is no world. Never has been. Wow. You know, these are the realizations we have to get to. There is no world. And someday this will dawn upon us, for sure. These are the fruits of good habits. So the fruit of good habits is liberation from the madness. Realizing what you really are, have always been. So, you know, frivolity is out. Frivolity is out. This nonsense of high technology, which causes us so much wasted time, actually, in so many ways. Causes us to dream big, thinking we should be able to do all this different stuff, and yet it wastes our time, it wastes our life. Life, I mean, that's the worst thing I can say about it. It wasted so many of my years of my life trying to think, wow, I can use this to do this. Oh, I can, if I just master this program, I can do this and I can do this. All the while, I'm not sitting quietly, like I don't have to do anything. It's kind of like you need to stop being an artist and suddenly someone comes in and expands your palette by, you know, tenfold. And they say, look at what you can do now. And you say, wow, look at the palette I have now. Like that. Did that with music, expanding the palette. So you get carried away. Look, graphic artists, all this stuff, the palette is expanded. But what you need to do is not do any of that stuff. Just sit quietly, don't do anything. The more committed you are to not doing anything, the easier it is to realize that you're absolutely free. You're not bound by any determinism, any force, time, space, process, and form. No one is bound. There isn't any bondage at all taking place anywhere, actually, in the whole, anywhere. So God has not been changed, has not been compromised at all. Why doesn't this arise? That's the big question. You know, it has to do with our continuity fear. Even the great teachers say, we can't really say when this is going to happen for you. You just have to keep working and working and working, and don't worry, eventually it will. Don't keep thinking, well, hey, this is supposed to happen. When, like a kid saying, when are we going to get there? When are we going to get there? When are we going to get there? Just pay attention to keeping your good habits going. And sooner or later, you realize, oh, I am there. So what is real religion? Just sit there and do nothing. Like, I don't have to do anything. Just sit there and be quiet. Get this feeling like I don't have to do anything. I can just sit here and be aware of my true identity and process the shock of that. That's it. There is quite a bit of shock to process. I just begin processing the shock. But of course your functionality will take a dip downwards, absolutely. When you get to the real severe wow, you will be stunned. And so, to say I don't have to do anything. I mean, people used to be way more successful at this because they didn't have to drive a car, for instance, or a bus or anything. No, they walked or rode a camel or a horse or an oxen or donkey or whatever. Or they could get in a train. So they didn't have to worry about some sort of sophisticated functioning, like driving a Silicon Valley. It's like, I feel like you're an electron in a microchip. You just wonder, can I get there? What's going to happen? It's like a Rubik's Cube. Everywhere there's this Rubik's Cube. It's like, Am I going to make it? This is horrible. What technology has wrought is absolutely horrible. And of course, always pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. This is one of their little jokes on everybody. Now, if you want a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, sit quietly and in the mood of, I don't need to do anything. I'm not going to even move from here. Society, they tithe, there's a tax, and a lot of money is given to make sure that there's no indigent people in that religion, that community. It's very important. Don't allow indigent people. When you go now, it's just an epidemic of homelessness, indigent people. It's just awful. I don't have the slightest feeling that someone is going to help me in the future here. So that whole principle is broken down to a large extent. But just when things are simple, it's easy to provide. You need a place here. Here's a place you can stay here for a while. That's not a problem. It's charity, compassion is very important. Those are all good habits. Test out the structure in this world. It's a waste of my time. These are good principles. Let the Holy Spirit take care of that. So we've talked about this is all a marketing campaign. What is existent? It is just a marketing campaign. This is a beautiful way to look at it. It's a higher way of looking at it. And people say, well, that's not in the scriptures. Well, the scriptures have more to do with just reminding you you need to develop good habits. Right? And once you have those good habits, then we'll talk some more. Jesus even said that. He says, you don't have good habits yet. You have terrible habits. You don't understand what I'm talking about. I can't bring the higher teaching to you because you're not ready for it. So first, start your good habits, and later on I'll come back and we'll talk some turkey. I'll explain to you, which is exactly what he did in A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words. Jesus brought back, says, here, okay, now let me explain to you the higher truth about it all. And with our good habits, we can handle it now. Because we say, wow, I think I just need to sit here, Jesus, and not do anything, begin and just full stop here. Because this is just tremendous, great good news. Everyone is perfect. Nobody has downgraded themselves in the slightest bit. Wow. There is no time. No one is bound at all. Wow. So what do we do when the world is falling apart and everybody's going crazy? Maintain our good habits. That's what we do. This is how Jesus says, I will know you. I will know you by what? Your good habits, of course. I will know my sheep because my sheep have been practicing these good habits. And they hear my voice, meaning the voice of truth. They can listen to my voice because they can maintain the good habits of, oh yeah, sit quietly, sit stilly, drop the world. I don't need to do anything. Drop the entire notion of anything being leveraged in the slightest bit, actually. Drop the notion, the concept of the world, relax my mind, release my thoughts, let them go. Full stop in the wow. I know when this overwhelms me, I sit quietly, I don't struggle with the struggle. This is the sheep, the good sheep, the good shepherd, who have practiced, have good habits. Don't be like the foolish, or the ones who didn't go out and get oil, and the groom comes in for the bride. I don't know how that was, but the foolish brides or something, and. They say, oh gosh, we need oil? Oh really? Okay, let me go run to the market to get it, and then the door's closed, too late. You can't get good habits and then the marketplace. You can't buy good habits. You have to get good habits before crises happen, which is why we're warned about crises ahead of time. And certainly, religions have warned us about mega crisis that's coming. In fact, we call it tribulation period, end time period. We're in that period now. We are in it. And it is a mega crisis for sure. So this is, we have to have our good habits going into this, which is why I was so adamant, did everything I could do. But very few are reached for some reason that I cannot fathom. because it's too late. Once it gets too late, it's too late. And you can't go to somebody and say, oh, we'll do anything for you, any amount of money, just help us out. No, it's not possible. It's your good habits that help you out. Nobody can do it for you. You have to maintain control of your own mind. You have to be able to continue to allow the good news to be arising for you. And nobody can do that for you. Doesn't matter whether you say you worship them as you know, king or queen of the world and universe, and you erect statues and churches and whatever you want. We'll maintain your estates. We'll give you an estate. We'll maintain the estate. We'll do everything, whatever. Useless. Save your money. Save your target. It does no good for you whatsoever. Which is why we're told that they'll be outside the gate wailing and gnashing in their teeth and distraught, because they didn't heed the warnings. They didn't work on good habits and didn't break the bad habits. Felt they didn't need to. Felt they could outsmart the whole thing situation. It's basic religious teaching. Basic, and Jesus focuses on this over and over and over and over and over and over in the Bible, Holy Bible, is it's all about good habits. The parables, good habits, good habits, good habits. Do it now, ahead of time. Don't wait. Tomorrow might be too late. So all the time, the Holy Spirit's telling me, hey, things are getting terrible here. You can't take it easy. Come on. Now tomorrow might be too late. Work on it today. So it's very important to realize we're under this pressure of those with super bad habits trying to institutionalize those bad habits and claim that these are good habits. that failure is success. This is what they're trying to do. That failure is success. That, hey, we can default, that we've changed what we are. We no longer need to worry about functioning as we were created to function. We've changed our functionality. This is their delusion. So bad habits don't matter. In fact, the more bad habits, the better. Let's everybody have bad habits, and then we'll just say, hey, everybody agrees. These are we all agree. Okay, well, let's just call them good habits now. Hey, right? Nothing to compare them with. So this is this massive delusion in the world now. People think, well, I've got to share all this data, I've got to share data. What are you sharing? Nonsense. You need to sit quietly and let the good data be shared with you from within. You already have. You're already hooked up to the ultimate server. Everyone already is. You don't need all this technology. You have to be aware of the data that's already within you. Data of truth. Instead, everybody's obsessed with trying to, you know, send Instagrams and Vines and tweets and likes and Facebook posting and, yeah, this terrible stuff's going on here and this is terrible. Oh, look what happened here. Look at that atrocity here. Oh, yeah, we have atrocity over here. Oh, I got even worse atrocity. Oh, look at this atrocity. Wow. Yeah, so you're like, wow, look at all the atrocities taking place. And oh my gosh, I'm so angry. I feel so vulnerable. I feel like, look how the world binds us to this horrible and stuff. Just reinforces delusion. Just reinforces delusion. It used to be that people who acted out criminally didn't get the time of day in the media. No responsible, you know, media, because they used to have standards. And or at least trying to uphold good habits. So if you act out in a very disruptive way, your punishment is no publicity whatsoever. Nowadays, the worse you act out, the more publicity you get. Who's got things backwards and upside down, right? Media does. They're not reporting on those who excel at good habits, truly good habits, and they're just make a frantically obsessed with those who are giving evidence of extremely bad habits, frantically obsessed by it. They know what they're doing as far as serving their, you know, their masters, their overseers. They're just carrying the water for them. So my hope was to start, you know, media channel, network, of focusing on good habits. Who, you know, bring to the attention of the world, good role models for everybody. And completely ignoring the bad role models, which they should be ignored in terms of role modelness, not in terms of being one with us, but in terms of role modelness, definitely ignored. Instead, these cretins are celebrated as something we all should be paying attention to. Now, growing up, they tried to, in magazines, they tried to give us good role models, except they were intellectual, humanistic role models. Dr. Albert Schweitzer, you know, Einstein, Gandhi. But they're still trying to say, hey, here's some good role models. You know, we were brought up on, but I realized, no, this is leading us astray because these are not good enough role models. This is weaning us away from the real good role models, the saints, the sages, the enlightened ones, the illumined ones, the realized ones, the gurus, you know, the saviors. These are the right role models. And to say, oh, no, these are too good for us. No, they're not. How can anything be too good for the Son of God? Which is what we are. How can anyone say that something is too good for us? That is absolutely, absolute nonsense. So I hope to, you know, have magazines, publications. I want to do everything. None of it took off. None of it was supported. No matter what I tried, it went nowhere. Except for this channel. This channel. Thanks for all the support. It's gone. It's you know, still clicking along. 900 subscriptions. 50 or so views for the videos. Some ones that are highlighted maybe get 150 or so. There haven't been any that have just like really. Except the ones of Ramana Maharshi and Ananda Mahima. But as far as my own videos, hasn't been any that have really gone viral or people are that interested. It's a sign of the times, huh? Maybe it would go to my head, so maybe the Holy Spirit's saying, no, it's not good for you. Possible. Probable, you know? Probable. It's not easy to handle success. But certainly, growing up, our culture tried to promote positive role models for us. They tried to be like this, try to be like this. This is a really good role model. Yeah, they tried. They did try. But I said, I want better role models. Because this is just telling me I'm a body. I'm a human being. I said, this is nonsense. I'm not a human being. What an insult. I mean, if you want to insult somebody, the greatest insult you can possibly call them a human being. That is just a vicious insult. But I'm not a body, I am free, I'm still spirit as God created me. I'm 100% spirit, the Son of God. Absolutely free to experience the absolute, endless totality of all experiencing. Nothing is too good for me. Nothing is too good for me. So, saying that I'm a human being is ludicrous. And it's the same for all of us. We are the one family. We are the one spiritual family, which is completely awesome. We are the one totally awesome spiritual family. And there's nothing too good for us in that spiritual family. The high highest, highest, best role model is not too good for us at all. Sri Sri Anandamayi, super high role model. Too good for us? Not at all. Not at all. Ramana Maharshi, super great role model. Too good for us? Not at all. So what I try to do is I just try to tell people, hey, look, this role model is not too good for me. It's not too good for you either. Come on, let's start paying attention to this role model. I'm sorry, but this is suddenly hitting me. My throat, right here. Wow. Another example, Jesus Christ. Is that too good of a role model for us? Absolutely not. We absolutely deserve such a role model. Every one of us. People say, ha, I don't deserve that. Who do you think I am? Anyway, I'm not just this human being. Born to die here. This is my home. What are you talking about? Eternal life? This utter nonsense. I don't deserve anything like that. Wrong, wrong, wrong. They say, look at all the bad habits I have. So many bad habits. How can you even think? Well, you spend a lot of effort in learning those bad habits. It's a testimony to your brilliance. It's not easy to get those bad habits. Remember, we're brilliant. This marketing campaign is brilliant. Every role we play is brilliant. You know, this is the right way to look at it. There's nobody here that's stupid, actually. Crazy, stupid. Everyone is here is exercising brilliance. But they're trying to outfox God, trying to con God, and there's no brilliance that can ever accomplish that. So it's also futile, which takes the bloom off the rose of brilliance, doesn't it? So it's brilliant, but whimsical. It's whimsical, and brilliance can dress up whimsicality. In many brilliant ways, it's still whimsicality. And so we can never overcome that. We have to accept it as it is. It's just a whimsical silliness. I can't sell God nothing. I mean, as far as a non-existent product, how come God take a non-existent product from me and say, okay, I'll take that from you. Okay, I agree you have this product. No, there's nothing there. There's no forced change. There's no force non-change. No. I remember my previous lives, especially one of them in particular, that I was able to look at and research, and it turns out all the bad habits that person had, I had them all. I had them all exactly the same. And the good habits, exactly the same. And I knew this is exactly who I was. And then I realized you carry your bad habits and your good habits with you into the next body, next situation. I said, holy cow. That's when I got very serious about it. Situation. Very sober. Remember, I don't have to do anything. I can just sit here. This is the most important civility you can give anyone in the world. Is to don't impose activity upon them. Do not impose activity upon them. And make sure that everyone, your friends and your family, feel perfectly okay about having a chunk of their day where they don't have to do anything. Very important. Before dinner, like 2 hours before dinner, they can spend without having to do anything at all. And if they're really into it, they don't even have to come to dinner. You see? Super important that you make sure that others realize that for you, you're not imposing any activity whatsoever upon them. And they can have chunks of time where they can feel like they're perfectly free to just sit and do absolutely nothing. This is basic civility. Basic culture, basic civility. Smartphone is one of the worst inventions in history, one of my most ruinous inventions possible. The children are being brought up feeling that they can be they being constantly in demand and interrupted. I'm going to have to respond to this, I have to check this, I have to check that. That totally breaks up the continuity of meditation, contemplation, full stop in the wowness. Totally breaks it up. You have to feel like, I don't have to answer to anyone, I don't have to do anything or answer to anyone for this big block of time. It just totally belongs to me and my own listening and hearing and wowism, completely. Because then that allows shifts to take place. That if you feel you have to be interacting with the world, you won't allow those shifts to take place. Because you'll feel you might be embarrassed, you might be feel confused, you might feel continuity issue, like I can't quite relate, and if you feel like somehow your status is slipping down, all these concerns about functionality, right? You don't have those concerns because I'm not going to deal with anyone. I don't have to deal with any aspect of the world whatsoever. This is key to success on the path. And what's done, the way that the tablets and the smartphones, the way the children are being raised up now, is they're being habituated to being constantly feeling that they have to respond, interact. Now, so horrible habits are being inculcated to the world's children. And you may think, wow, isn't that terrible? Well, keep in mind that these people who are coming into the world now already have these habits with them. So for them, it's easy. They're just getting back into their bad habits. There are some that don't have them, and then this is really a struggle for them. Right? They say, "Well, I don't really want this. I don't like this." So people say, "Well, you don't have a smartphone." I say, "That's right. I'm trying to set a good example for others." Yeah, I don't have a smartphone. I'm Clarity Ross, and I don't have a smartphone. Setting a good example for the young people of the world. Everybody in the world is treasure your time that belongs to you, where you don't have to interact with the world at all. The world doesn't even have to exist for you. And then you can realize that the world actually doesn't exist for anyone. That's very true. Hated school because you gotta interact, gotta study these books. I didn't want to interact. I said, let me sit here quietly. This world's very difficult. This bizarre place is a madhouse here. I need to keep reminding myself of truth. This is what you do when you're young, because otherwise you're going to go down in the rabbit hole and start picking up all sorts of bad habits. So I didn't like school at all. A little bit interaction, sure, is fine, but you should have the right to just stop. And now the teachers tell you, this is what you have to do. Okay, you gotta interact this way, This generation, they're just in such a horrendous situation by their own choice, of course. Many have very bad habits from previous incarnations in various places throughout the cosmos. There are many technology planets where all this kind of interaction is normal. That's what they do, you know, where they're constantly distracted by gadgets, constantly. You know, reaction, like I tweet a reaction, oh, react, and this happened, only react, or this happened, only react. And then let me hate on your reaction. So you just get all this reaction, instant reaction. Oh, a celebrity did this. Oh, you know, millions of people are tweeting. Oh, this is my reaction. Instead of saying, hey, for these 2 hours, the world doesn't even exist for me. It doesn't even exist. I have no interaction or reaction or opinion about the world whatsoever. I am listening to the truth within that tells me that there is no world. Never has been and never will be. No time, no space, no process, no form. Nothing determining my next instant of experiencing. Nothing forcing me to maintain what I've been experiencing. Nothing forcing me to change what I've been experiencing. I'm absolutely free. I'm a complete, free, sovereign, spiritual son of God. This is the truth. I don't have to interact with the world at all during this time while I'm listening. So it doesn't matter what's taking place in the world. It actually never matters what's taking place. Because nothing is taking place, actually. But I need the time for a while to react to that. You see, where I'm reacting to truth, the gospel, the good, I'm reacting to the great good news. I'm taking this time to react to great good news. I'm not going to react to anything else other than that. This is the habit that that is all important. This is the habit that is under siege by the most severe plague and epidemic this world has ever seen. When we talk about the plagues and epidemics of the end time, this smartphone, tablet, you know, let's call it that, smartphone plague, is the worst plague in history. It's a spiritual plague. Every kid I see seems like walking to school. Either got the earbuds on or they're, you know, playing Damon. They look, oh, traffic? Is there traffic somewhere? Okay. Meanwhile, the drivers are like, whoa, look out for this person. Why are they walking against the light? What are they doing? Holy God, it's dangerous. The kid is just like, yeah, we gotta keep dealing with this here. Yeah. So, we got to share this. React to this. Oh, are you paying attention? Oh, this, and react to this. Again, the truth is already within everybody. So there's no reason to share with anyone in those terms. What's helpful is to set a good role model, be a good role model, and help people with good habits to listen within. Listening within to the truth that's within us is the good habit we need. So that is justified and valid as far as getting, you know, getting the important, you know, telling others about this. That is important. Sharing it with others. Reminder, truth is within. Have you listened today to truth? Have you listened within? Have you listened within today? Have you given the truth within you a chance to reveal itself? Have you allowed the good news to tell you what you really are? I call it the good news. I tend not to personify it. I think you get into a world of trouble when you try to start personifying it. That leads to conflicts and that leads to a lot of stuff. It's better to, I call it the good news, the really, really good news of what we truly are, which is we are sons of God, absolutely, S-U-N-S. We radiate bliss 360 degrees, equally, constantly, effortlessly. Radiate freedom and bliss, love, gratitude. We are all sons of God. So we get to experience this, right? So within us is the great good news. It's not a person within us. It's the great good news that we're not a person, actually. We're not a body, we're not a form, we're not a process, we're not time, not space, we're not bound at all. We're formless, radiantness. This is the good news within us. We're not a person at all. We're not a personality. Saying this teacher's the best or this teacher's the best. Well, why do we need to personify it to that extent? The great good news is exactly the same within everyone. You see? It's that I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. That is the truth within everyone. What's the best? What do you mean? What's the best? It's all exactly the same for everyone. Who's the best role model? Well, there's many good role models. You don't have to worry about the best so much because all you have to do is be quiet and listen to the great good news is the same within everyone, whether you have the best role model or the second best or third, doesn't matter, right? It's the same great good news. The great good news you reach it by having the best role model will be the same great good news that someone reaches by having the third best role model. It won't be the slightest bit different. So why make a big deal about who's the best? That's like saying, well, my good news is going to be better than your good news. No, it's not. Just use whatever role model helps you. And sometimes you go to use this one, or sometimes, you know, sometimes I go to Sri Sakadana Maharaj for an occasional with that flavor, you know, get some chili peppers or something. And other than I say, nah, I want to go back to Jesus now, and so I'll go back to Jesus, that's fine. It's not like, hey, if I don't just stick with this one teacher, the good news is going to change. No, it can't change. Or it's not like, if I don't go to all these different teachers, the good news isn't going to be as good for me. No, the good news cannot change. It's perfect for everyone. The good news is exactly the same for everyone, without any exceptions. It's kind of cool saying this stuff at this time. Fantasy clay, the end of the world. it's pretty cool to be saying this stuff because it's outrageously counterculture, isn't it? Not that it makes the good news any better for anyone, right? It's already perfect. It doesn't have to be done in an outrageously counterculture way. Doesn't have to be done in a cool way, like, hey, look how we're not supposed to be doing this, but we're doing it anyway. It doesn't have to be done that way. But for some reason, some people like kind of that, yeah, it's fine too. Doesn't make it, the news doesn't change the news in any way. Seems a little more adventurous this way, doesn't it? You know, Godzilla is like completely tearing the planet to pieces, and here we are. Laughing about it, and practicing and saying everything's perfect. I mean, the good news is perfect, than anyone. It can never change, no matter what Godzilla does. Makes absolutely no difference. So we cover so much territory, so much outrageously countercultural information and attitudes. Speaking, you know, the great good news can never be changed within us whatsoever, whether we're meditating right or listening right or wrong. It never changes at all. So just relax. Don't worry about it. Just keep the habit going. Just keep practicing. And just be willing to say, it's okay if I'm not so, it feels like my functionality takes a dip. That's okay. If I seem a little stupid, that's okay. And then allow the wow, information will, clarity will arise. Prepare for it. Invite it. And it will be there for you. Now, there's a little wow here. I have a hard time to say, what should I go over everything again? No, I can't quite. I can't say, what did I say? So that means I've been able to build up some wow factor here. Is when you try to go back, you realize I can't really, you know, don't struggle with it. Don't try to remember. Just full stop in the wow right now. The wow that is right now. So it evaporates a little bit. See, this is the time for full stop where you should not have to do anything. You're purposefully not doing anything. You're not going in any direction because you're feeling a little wobbly, right? The last thing you want to do when you feel wobbly is to seize upon a direction. Just say, hey, you know, I just want to wobble around a little bit right here. I don't want to start riding off somewhere because I'm a little bit not quite sure where I'm going next, actually. So. I'll just cycle around in circles here for a little while. Just circle around and like that. California continues to be his usual awesome self. Weather-wise, and yet going out to stores, it is absolutely horrendous here. The people, the attitudes, it's a sharp take. It's a place where people who have the worst habits in the world tend to congregate. All celebrating these bad habits together, thinking that somehow that makes them good habits. And of course they think that failure to realize what we are is success. They think that's success. And they think that by insisting that no, we're not what we really are, that God will buy this from us, you know, we'll be able to market this to God. And and we'll be even smarter than God, you see. We created something out of nothing. Created an imprisonment out of freedom. So that's what they think. They just will, the bad habits will eventually win out. So that's why they're working so constantly on them. So thank everyone I come across, and thank you for reminding me what how terrible bad habits are and what they lead you toward too. Thank you. don't want to go out in this world. When once you spend quiet time, you realize how superior it is. Wow. Activity everywhere. Activity everywhere. And of course people are going to interrupt and insist upon some interaction and activity. They don't honor quiet time here. Not now, not in this world, no way. They'll just call you a kook. You know, they say, who are you to tell me I got bad habits, you crazy kook. You know, that's how they'll push back on you, you know, harshly. It's a nightmare living in this place. But just showing people, hey, even in this terrible place, can get the job done. No excuses. The birds are always so active, you know. I always say to the birds, hey bird, just say hello to me, you know, what's the big deal? Can you not just, for a moment, just say, hey, nice to see you, happy to see you today, just, and just let that moment be without any in a worldly interaction, can it, John, just be this quiet moment? No, the birds are always, you know, looking and checking. They can't. Only one bird ever did that for me. Very odd bird, blue jay. It would just fly real close to me here and just perch somewhere and then just look at me like this. Just look at me. He used to visit me all the time. Listening or was trying to convey something. The bird was completely different than all other birds I've ever seen. It didn't act like a bird at all. It would act like a spirit. But I get up in the morning, I see little birds, I say, hey bird, good morning. You know, nice to see you. You know, you're my neighbor, you live right here, we both live here. How about exchanging pleasantries? How about saying, hey, may the day be blessed with a block of time where you don't have to worry about anything, function at all. No, the bird's just, come on, bird. Why can't you just say, fly up and say hello? Tweet a hello. Nah, they won't do it. That's crazy. What is that? No, there's so much activity. Pushed on me, you know. Be active. Be interactive. Come on. Show how functional you are. Show how well adapted you are to this world and to the belief in time, space, process, and form. Be a good role model for stupidity, for bad habits. Be a good role model for bad habits. Someone there. Just closing car doors and various things. I just stayed here, stayed put. But nobody even knows I'm doing this, because if they did, they'd for sure find a way to disrupt it. For sure. This is what I found out, that when people find out that you are actually taking these blocks of time where you feel you don't need to interact with anyone, they feel they're doing you a favor by disturbing and interrupting it. They feel they're doing you a favor. They say, well, you can't have good habits like that. That's going to cause you a big problem. Big problem. Because something might arise from within and it's going to freak you out. No, I said, no. It's the good habits that enable us to not freak us out. They say, well, if you have bad habits, it won't or never won't arise. It's not there anymore. No, it's still there. So it still has to arise eventually. You're just wasting time, just delaying. Well, we can change what's within us, the good news there. We can buy our bad habits. No, you cannot. No, you cannot. Well, if you're having good habits, you're going to make it better. No, I cannot make it any better. It's already perfect. So is there any place you can go where you don't need good habits? No. Even in the real world, death-free realm, still, there's the need for the fullness arising of your freedom, except your perfect freedom. You're not even bound to the death-free realm. You don't have to stay there forever. You don't have have to leave, you don't have to stay. So you still have to keep, you know, the good habits going. You know, just say, oh, okay, I don't even need to pay any attention to what's with him. Now, same thing, full stop and the wow. Full stop and like, wow. Wow, this really reminds me of something. Oh, this reminder seems to be welling up even more. Like, wow, this is very intense. This is great. This is... So in this culture, it's pretty difficult to avoid bad habits because everyone's, the whole cultural ocean of interaction is all bad habits, basically. Other than basic civility, but it's all bad habits. It's the whole pace of everything. So, you know, but the answer is keep your good habits going, and that will nullify, overcome the bad habits for sure. Because, for instance, if you have a habit of overeating and you're trying to diet, and you say, let me just go to a Greek island, and you know, it's wonderful food, and it's kicked back, and it's so beautiful here. Oh, I can overeat here. That's not a problem. No, because it's so beautiful. See, this is no longer a problem. It's not a bad habit here. So you eat. What do you expect? You're not going to gain weight? Yeah, of course you will. So it's hell to stop these videos because I know I have to go back inside. Computers there, you know, there's probably golf on TV or what is this thing? Yeah, I mean, you have to eat. I just like, what do I do? What do I do? What do I do? It's terrible. What do I do? That's why monastic life has these calendars of activities where. Okay, now you're done with this, and you go to prayer, and you have your meal, and then you have your prayer before that, the after meal prayer, and you know, it's a lot. It can be overwhelming, you know, in some way. Now, eating is one way people is they try not to do anything. So I'm just eating, so I'm doing something. And gain weight. I mean, that'd be a great, nice help. I mean, I understand that if you just eat and don't gain any weight, then you could feel it's okay and not, your mind doesn't have to be engaged in anything. I'm not reading news stories. I'm not, you know, involved with all this distractions. I'm just sitting here quietly eating. But that too is a little distracting. So what to do, what to do, what to do? Oh, man, this is brutal. Try to read some from the books, try to read some. And focus on, you know, that I'm going to need to do another video and see how it goes. Okay, so very great. That's enough for this one. Although I could keep going. I think there's a limit, 2-hour, 10-minute limit on YouTube. So, yeah, I'll just keep churning out the 2-hour videos. It is, again, encouragement, 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 encouragement. Good habits, good habits, good habits. Good role model. Along with the higher truth, the higher truth, the higher truth. And this is how we offset these times. Don't react to the times. I say, hey, times, you want to react to something, react to my good habits. That's what you need to react to. Because that's what's going on, right? Good habits are what's going on here. We'll see what we can do. Very great, that's it.